हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माय सेल्फ असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर संतोष नपते, वर्किंग इन डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ माइक्रोबायोलॉजी, संभाजीराव केंद्रीय महाविद्यालय, जळकोट. फ्रेंड्स, इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू सी अबाउट द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ मॉलिकुलर सीजर्स और विच आर ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज रेस्ट्रिक्शन एंडोन्यूक्लियेजेस. सो इन दिस टॉपिक वी विल सी detail about this restriction endonucleases are also called as restriction enzymes, or these are also known as the molecular scissors. So these enzymes, they cut down these DNA molecules. So that's why these are working as a scissors for these molecules. So that's why these are called as molecular scissors. So without wasting time, let's start with this different restriction endonucleases or different types of molecular scissors. So as I told in previous slide, these molecular scissors, these are also called as the restriction enzymes. So what are these restriction enzymes? So restriction enzymes, or which are also called as restriction endonucleases, so these are the enzymes that cuts the double stranded or single stranded DNA at a specific recognition nucleotide sequence. So from this definition we can understand here what is meant by these molecular scissors or what are these restriction enzymes. So these restriction enzymes, these are nothing but the enzymes which cut down that single stranded or double stranded DNA molecule. So this is very important for the definition of that enzymes or restriction endonucleases. So these, they cut down the double stranded or single stranded DNA molecule at a specific recognition sequences or nucleotide sequences, and that specific recognition nucleotide sequence, that is called as the restriction site. It is known as restriction site, or that is called as recognition site. For example, if that double stranded DNA molecule, that enzyme, suppose this is the double stranded DNA molecule here having the sequence of adenine, for example, then guanine, nucleotide, or see, this is the, suppose here that double stranded sequences are here, and then if that particular DNA molecule, it cutting that DNA here, for example, so this site, it is called as the restriction site. So this site, it is called as restriction site, or it is known as recognition site. So in this way, that is called as the recognition site, or it is known as restriction site. So the next point is here, that properties of restriction enzymes. So what are the properties of restriction enzymes? The most important property of that restriction enzyme includes these restriction endonucleases or these molecular scissors, they break the phosphodiester bond. So these are responsible for the breaking of phosphodiester linkage or phosphodiester bond, and this phosphodiester bond, it connects or it link the adjacent nucleotides in a DNA molecule. So whatever that different types of nucleotides are present in DNA molecule, so all these nucleotides from one strand, they are connected with each other with the help of these phosphodiester bonds or phosphodiester linkage. And these restriction enzymes, they actually break this phosphodiester bond or that linkage. Now the next point is how these restriction enzymes works, or how they perform their function. That means how these restriction endonucleases or restriction enzymes, they cut down that DNA molecule at that restriction site, or which is also called as the recognition sequences, where that enzyme recognizes that particular sequence and cut down that DNA within the sequence. That's why it is called as the recognition sequence. So these restriction enzymes, they recognize a specific sequence of nucleotide. So when there is a specific sequence is present in that DNA molecule, so that specific sequence, it is recognized by these restriction enzyme, and this restriction enzyme later on they produces a double-stranded cut. It produces a double-stranded cut within that DNA molecule, and whatever these cuts are formed here, these cuts are of two different types. So there are two different types of cuts are there which are produced by these restriction enzymes. One is called as blunt end and another one is called as sticky end. So these are the two cuts which are produced by this restriction endonucleases, blunt ends and sticky ends. So that we will see what are these blunt ends and what are these sticky ends. These are the diagrams of that two ends, which are the blunt ends and the sticky ends. See here, when that particular restriction endonuclease cuts down that DNA molecule within that DNA strands, so the cuts which are formed in this way, like this here. So these ends are called as the blunt ends, and when there is a cutting of that DNA molecule in this way or in this fashion, then here this is the one nucleotide, this is one nucleotide, or whatever that cut is formed here, it will be in this way here. So that such types of cuts, these are called as sticky ends. So these are the cuts which are produced by the restriction endonucleases. One is blunt end and second one is the sticky end. And you can easily understand from these two diagrams what are means by blunt end and what are these sticky ends here. So what are these blunt ends? We have seen in previous diagram. And these blunt ended fragments which are produced with the help of restriction endonucleases, that can be joined to any other DNA fragment having this blunt end. Suppose if you are having one DNA molecule and you utilize that restriction enzyme for the cutting of that DNA molecule, and after cutting with the help of these enzymes, that two fragments are formed here having these blunt ends. So these blunt ends that can be used to join the another DNA molecules, or that can be inserted in another DNA molecule or any other DNA fragment having such blunt ends. And these are very useful for the DNA cloning experiments or for DNA cloning. So sticky ends, these are very useful for DNA cloning also. And that DNA fragments with complementary sticky ends. So in previous diagram, we have seen that whatever that ends are formed here, these are called as sticky ends, and it means they have the complementary base pairing, and that can be combined to create or to form a new DNA molecule which allows the creation and manipulation of DNA sequences from different sources. So with the help of these sticky ends, you can create new DNA molecule, or you can join sequences of new DNA molecules, and that results into the formation of new or recombinant DNA. So these sticky ends, these are useful for the formation or making of new DNA molecule, or which are also called as recombinant DNA molecule. So what are these recognition sequences are here? So all these recognition sequences, these are different for different restriction enzymes or for different molecular scissors. And the length of these recognition sequences, it is between 4 and 8 nucleotides. So many of these sequences, they are palindromic. That we will see what is meant by these palindromic sequences. So it means when you are reading that nucleotide sequence from left to right and from right to left, it has the same meaning, for example. So this is called as the palindrome, or that sequences are called as palindromic sequences. And these recognition sequences, these are different for different restriction enzymes, and they generally measures about 4 to 8 nucleotides. So see here, what is meant by palindrome in DNA sequences? So palindromic sequences means, as I told here, see, this is the one diagram of this DNA molecule here, a short fragment having the sequence guanine, adenine, adenine, thymine, thymine, cytosine. So when you are reading from this site here, so having this sequence GAATTC. So when you are from the other side here, it has this sequence GAATTC. So it means when you will read from this side to this side and from this side to this side, then it has the same sequence here. So this is called as the palindromic sequences. And these genetic palindromes, these are similar to verbal palindromes. So here a palindromic sequence in DNA is one in which the 5 prime to 3 prime base pair sequence is identical. Means here, suppose for example 5 prime to 3 prime, the sequence is GAATTC, and if you are measuring from 5 prime to this 3 prime, it has the same sequence GAATTC. So this is called as the palindromes, or that is called as palindromic sequences. So that's why we can see here DNA palindromic sequences are those sequences in which the DNA is one in which the 5 prime to 3 prime base pair sequence is identical on both strands. So here the 5 prime and 3 prime end refers to the chemical structure of the DNA. See here on the strands, there this is suppose 5 prime end, then this will be the 3 prime, and if it is the 5 prime end, then this will be 3 prime, because we know that the both strands on the DNA molecule, these are anti-parallel in nature. So one runs in 5 prime to 3 prime direction and another strand runs in the same way, that is 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Okay, that is anti-parallel nature. So the next point here, again that palindrome sequences. So the mirror-like palindromes in which the same forward and backwards are on a single strand of the DNA strand, as in GTAATC. So on the second strand, what will be the sequence here? Again, it will be C, or that sequence will be same here. Okay. Then the inverted repeat palindromes is also a sequence that reads the same forward and backwards. That is forward direction or and backward direction will be same, but the forward and backward sequences, these are found in the complementary DNA strands. And inverted repeat palindromes, these are more common and they have the great biological importance than mirror-like palindromes. Okay. So next one will be here, that is star effect. So that optimum conditions, which are, these are very necessary for the expected result. And when there is the extreme conditions are there, for example, elevated pH, or that means high pH or low ionic strength, then these restriction enzymes, these are capable of breaking or cleaving sequences, and that are similar but not identical to their recognition sequences. This is called as star effect. So next point we will see about the nomenclature of restriction enzymes, because there are so many enzymes are there and how these enzymes are named. So that we will see under the heading nomenclature of these restriction enzymes. And each enzyme or restriction enzyme, it is named after the bacteria from where these enzymes are produced, or from which these enzymes was isolated using a naming system, and that is based on the name of bacterial genus, then name of bacterial species and name of the strain. Just take this example here, ECoR1. This is the Roman numbers here. So ECoR1, so we will see what this E stands for, CO stands for, R means, or these Roman numbers. What are these Roman numbers? So we will see in next slide. See, these are some other examples here. So when there is a name is there, for example, this ECoR1, it means that E, it is taken, this is the source of bacteria, this is the name of enzyme here. But actually, this enzyme, the name is given according to the source organism. Here, this E stands for the first letter of the genus of Escherichia. So that's why it is E. And this CO, it is taken from the first two letters of the species. And these are written in small. Okay. So this enzyme, it is isolated or purified from the Escherichia coli. So that's why it is called as the ECO. So that E, it is written in capital alphabet. And this E is taken from the first letter of the genus name, that is Escherichia. Then CO, it is written in small letters, and these two letters, these are taken from the first two letters of the species, that is coli. That R is the strain, and this Roman number, it indicates that this is the first enzyme which is purified from the Escherichia coli. Okay. So here abbreviation, that is E, it means Escherichia, and that description, it is the genus. Then CO, it is taken from the species name coli, so description, it is this species. Then R, the meaning of this R, it is the strain RY13. So description, it is strain. And this Roman enzyme first, it indicate this enzyme is the first identified enzyme in Escherichia coli, and this is the order of identification in the bacteria. So this is the first enzyme ECOR1. Okay, so this is the illustration of this name of enzyme here. So that we will see. Next point, it is the types of restriction enzymes. So which are the different types of restriction enzymes? So actually there are three different types of restriction endonucleases, and these are called as type 1. So these restriction enzymes types includes, one is type 1, then second one type 2 restriction endonucleases, and third one is type 3 restriction endonucleases. So here one by one we will see in short, that is these three different types of restriction endonucleases. So these are the another types of restriction endonucleases here, that is type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, and there are some artificial restriction enzymes which are prepared in the research laboratories. So these different types of restriction endonucleases, these are categorized on the basis of their composition, then enzyme cofactor requirement, then the nature of their target sequence, and position of their DNA cleavage site, that is called as the recognition site, which is related to the target sequence. The first one is here, that is type 1 restriction enzymes or type 1 molecular scissors. Actually these are called as the type 1 RE, means restriction enzymes. And these type 1 restriction enzymes, they are capable of both restriction as well as modification activities. Means they can limit the sequences here, or they can modify the sequences. And the cofactors for these enzymes which are required, these are S adenosyl methionine, that is AdOMET, ATP, and Mg2 plus ions. These are required for the full activity of this type 1 restriction endonucleases. And this type 1 restriction endonucleases, they consist of two restriction subunits, then two methylation subunits, and one specificity subunits. So this is the simple composition of this type 1 restriction endonucleases. And these enzymes, they cleave or they break that DNA molecule at the random length from the recognition site. Then type 2 restriction endonucleases, these are most commonly available, and these are most used restriction enzymes in recombinant DNA technology or in genetic engineering. So that type 2 enzymes, these are most commonly available as well as used restriction enzymes. Then they are composed only one subunit. There is presence of only one subunit, and their recognition sites, these are usually undivided, and these are palindromic in nature, having the length of 4 to 8 nucleotides. Then the recognize and cleave DNA at the same site. So wherever there is a recognition site is there, at this, in this or within this site, these type 2 restriction endonucleases, they break or they cleave that DNA molecule. And they do not use ATP for their activity as the energy source, but they usually require that Mg2 plus ions for their activity. Okay, also that Mg2 plus, it acts as a cofactor. Next one is here, type 3 restriction endonucleases. So these type 3 restriction enzymes, they cut down that DNA molecule about 20 to 30 base pairs after the recognition site. So suppose there is a recognition site is identified by this type 3 restriction endonucleases, but these enzymes, they are not cutting that DNA molecule within this recognition site, as like type 2 restriction enzymes. But this type 3, they will cut that DNA molecule after, that is about 20 to 30 base pairs after the recognition site. So once recognition site is completed, from that site, after 20 to 30 base pairs, that type 3 enzyme will cut down that DNA molecule. And these enzymes, they contain more than one subunit, and they require adenosyl methionine as well as ATP as a cofactors for their roles in DNA methylation and in restriction. Then type 4 restriction endonucleases, they cleave only normal and modified DNA molecule. Modified in the sense which is methylated, which is hydroxymethylated, and which is glucosyl hydroxymethylated. Okay, so that modified DNA molecule. These are cut by this type 4 restriction endonucleases, and that recognition sequences, they have not been well defined in this type 4 restriction endonucleases. That's why they are not generally used in the genetic engineering or in recombinant DNA technology. And the breaks or that cleavage, it takes place near about 30 base pairs away from one of the recognition site. And the last one is here, that is called as artificial restriction enzymes. So these are generated by using a natural or the engineered DNA binding domain to a nuclease domain. These are the artificial restriction enzymes. They can target large DNA sites up to 36 base pairs, and that can be engineered to bind to a desired DNA sequences because these are artificial restriction enzymes. So the examples of type 2 restriction enzymes, because these are the most commonly available as well as commonly used restriction enzymes in genetic engineering. So that's we will see the examples. So this EcoR1, that E stands for the genus, that is Escherichia, and this first letter is taken here. Then CO, it is taken from the species name, that is coli, C-O-L-I. So these two alphabets are taken. Then R, it is the strain name, RY13, and this Roman 1, it is the first endonuclease enzyme which is purified or which is isolated from the Escherichia coli. Another example is here, that is BAMH1. That B stands for, that is taken from the name of genus, that is Bacillus. This AM, it is taken from the species name. This first two letter, that is Amyloliquefaciens. That H, it is the strain name. And that 1, Roman 1, it is the first endonuclease enzyme isolated from the Bacillus amyloliquefaciens. Next one is here, next example, that is HIND3. So that H again is, it is taken from the genus name, and the genus is here Haemophilus. So that first alphabet is taken here from the genus name, and it is written in capital in the name of enzyme. Then IN, it is taken from the species name, that is first two letters Influenzae, that is IN, and it is written in small letter. Then D, it is the strain name, that is RD, and that Roman 3, it indicates this HIND3, it is the third endonuclease enzyme which is purified from the Haemophilus influenzae. Okay, so next point is here, that is isocisome 1. So restriction enzymes which are specific to the same recognition sequence, these are called as isocisomers. For example, here SPH1, so the having recognition sequence is CGTACG. This slash, it indicates the cutting site here. So when we use this particular enzyme here, so this enzyme, it cut down that DNA molecule within this sequence. But where it is cutting that DNA molecule? Here, that is after the cytosine nucleotide here. So this enzyme, it makes the cut after or between this CG. And another enzyme, BBUL, it having the recognition sequence, that is CGTACZ. So this enzyme also makes the cut between this cytosine and guanine. So both of these enzymes, they have the same recognition sequence here. So that's why these are called as isocisomers of each other. Okay. So the next one is here, that is about the neocisomer. Next point is here, that is neocisomer. So neocisomers are enzymes that recognizes the same sequence, but it cuts in differently at locations. So that is called as the neocisomer. For example, here this name of enzyme is SMAL, and having the recognition sequence CCCGGG. But this enzyme, it makes the cut within this recognition sequence, that is between the cytosine and guanine at the central position, for example, here. And another enzyme, that is called as XMAL, having the same recognition sequence, but this enzyme, it makes the cut after first nucleotide, that is after between cytosine and cytosine. Okay, so both of these enzymes, that is SMAL and XMAL, they having the same recognition sequence, but they makes the cut at different locations or different position. So then such enzymes are called as neocisomers. Okay. Next point is here, that is applications of restriction enzymes. So the first application is here, these restriction enzymes, they are used in gene cloning as well as in protein expression experiments. Another application is here, restriction enzymes, they are most widely used in recombinant DNA technology for the formation of recombinant DNA or new DNA molecule. Then these are used for the detection of RFLPs, that means restriction fragment length polymorphism. Then these are also used for the mapping of DNA molecule, and these are used in genotype a DNA sample by small nucleotide fragments, okay, or SNPs. So here we have seen about the restriction enzymes or molecular scissors, their nomenclature, their types and examples, and finally application. So friends, if you are not subscribed this Microbiology by Santosh Napte, kindly subscribe this channel so that you will get notifications about the upcoming videos. In next lecture we will see about the genetic engineering vectors, or vectors which are used in the recombinant DNA technology, or which are used in genetic engineering. Thank you.